Welcome to Prophecy News Update. I'm Tom Gilbreath. Uncertainty hangs in the air. In the last few days, we've heard some scary things, as well as some hopeful ones. On Palm Sunday, the Surgeon General of the United States declared that Holy Week in 2020 would be the hardest and saddest week of most Americans' lives. Wow. Several hotspots, though not all, have shown a surprising slowdown in the growth rate of new infections and new hospitalizations. If you get the impression that no one really knows what will happen next, you're right. We depend on ever-changing computer models to tell us what's going to happen. The problem is that computer models are easily manipulated. Also, they change constantly because they're fed new and unexpected data. Computer models are not straight science. They are opinion dependent. By that I mean that the models may vary depending on the opinion of the model makers regarding how much weight to give various bits of information. In other words, humans are the ones who decide what's important, and they rarely agree with one another. Finally, no one really knows how to model a new virus because it's new. We have no experience with it. A professor of math at Temple University recently spoke to the Associated Press about computer modeling the virus. He said, "Uncertainty is the only certainty there is." As you would expect, he stated it with mathematical precision. We have to be careful not to see the story only in terms of numbers, but it is the size of the pandemic that decides the size of the response. Look at the 2017-2018 flu season. 61,000 Americans died of the flu during those few months. That doesn't diminish what's happening now, but it gives us important perspective. The people dying today are important, but so were those 61,000 people. We didn't stop shaking hands. We didn't stop going to work, school, or church. We didn't wear masks or other protective gear. The nation did not shut down. So why is this worth all the precautions we're giving it? Here's why. With COVID-19, we are skating on the precipice of disaster. In mid-March, the Imperial College of London released a study predicting that the United States death toll could be as high as 2.2 million. A month ago, the U.S. Centers for Disease Control were predicting the possibility of a similarly vast calamity. On March 13th, Sherry Fink of the New York Times wrote, "Between 160 million and 214 million people in the United States could be infected over the course of the epidemic. As many as 200,000 to 1.7 million people could die." She was using official CDC numbers. Later, we may learn that we overreacted. Or worse, we may learn that we were willfully manipulated. So far, there are lots of conspiracy theories. For now, Prophecy News Update will defer that discussion until we learn more. In some areas, we may be seeing light at the end of the tunnel, but that does not mean we should ease off on the precautions. Think of COVID like electricity. You turn it off by breaking the circuit. That's social distancing. It's not yet time to come back into close physical contact, but it's suddenly easier to imagine a time when we can. When we have been delivered from this pestilence, how will we respond? Suppose you were studying the Bible one day and you found a scripture indicating that COVID-19 would end the Sunday after Easter in the year 2020. In case you're reaching for a concordance, no, there is no such scripture. But suppose there was something like that and you found it. What would you do? Shout hallelujah? Send out word on social media? Call your friends? Start making vacation plans? Maybe buy into the stock market. Would you get tough with God, ordering him to fulfill his word right now or else? How would you react? There's no verse like that, so it's not going to happen, but something along those lines did happen a long time ago to a man named Daniel. You remember him. He was thrown one night into a den of hungry lions and came out the next morning unscathed. As a teenager, Daniel had been part of the great Babylonian exile. He was stolen away from his home in Jerusalem and taken to the city of Babylon, where he was made to serve the king. The event had been foretold by many Old Testament prophets. Through them, God warned Israel in advance that unless they repented and turned back to him, such a calamity would take place. One of those prophets, Jeremiah, not only told about the coming captivity, he also said exactly how long it would last. The 9th chapter of his book, Daniel tells about finding Jeremiah's prophecy. Maybe Daniel came across Jeremiah 25:12, or maybe it was this verse, Jeremiah 29:20. For thus says the Lord, after 70 years are completed at Babylon, I will visit you and perform my good word toward you and cause you to return to this place. Talk about exciting. By this time, the 70 years were almost over. How does Daniel respond to this great news? You might expect him to dance a jig or run down the street rejoicing and telling his friends about the happy news. Daniel did none of those things. Daniel repented. Just for context, understand that the Bible consistently tells us about the flaws of its heroes, often in disgusting detail. But it never says a bad thing about Daniel. In all the Bible, only Jesus is more above reproach. And yet, the first thing Daniel did was repent. Instead of calling a feast, he fasted in sackcloth and ashes. He wrote, I set my face toward the Lord God to make request by prayer and supplications with fasting, sackcloth, and ashes. And I prayed to the Lord my God and made confession and said, O Lord, great and awesome God, who keeps his covenant and mercy with those who love him and with those who keep his commandments, we have sinned and committed iniquity. We have done wickedly and rebelled, even by departing from your precepts and your judgments. Neither have we heeded your servants, the prophets. O Lord, righteousness belongs to you, but to us, shame of face. He constantly included himself in these transgressions. Verse 10 says, we have not obeyed the voice of the Lord our God to walk in his laws. On Facebook and elsewhere, I see a lot of comfort being given out, and that's good. People are in turmoil and they need comfort, but in all we're going through, I hope we will also remember repentance. And by that, I don't mean putting blame on some specific group of sinners. I'm talking about examining ourselves in light of his word. Maybe you're like Daniel. Maybe you have less to repent of than anyone else in the world. Even so, follow Daniel's example and surrender anew to God's will and to his ways. One characteristic of people in the time just before Christ returns is that they refuse to repent. Never let that be said of those of us who are in Christ Jesus. Our sins are forgiven, but we need to constantly realign our lives and our will with God's will as expressed in his word. And what better time than in the midst of a global catastrophe, a kind of catastrophe prophesied by Jesus as one of the signs of his soon return. So what is the disease behind the disease? It's the disease behind all diseases. COVID-19 is the name of a disease. The germ causing it is known as severe acute respiratory syndrome coronavirus 2 or SARS-CoV-2. Symptoms include fever, a dry cough, and difficulty breathing. There is no known cure. But behind all disease is the disease known as death. The germ that causes the disease is known as sin. And we're all infected. The chief symptom is pain. But thanks be to God, the disease of death does have a cure, Jesus. You can experience the cure right now. He invites you to join his family and enter his care. It's not about saying just the right words. It's about turning over your heart and life to his will and care. He has made himself available right now. God willing, I'll see you soon.